Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. In this episode, at long last, the much delayed and extremely expensive successor to Hubble, the James Webb Space Telescope, is finally all in one piece and passed some initial tests that opened the fragile and very large sun shield that will protect the telescope cameras from the sun while in space. So, what's next for this mission? Stick around. Well, we haven't talked about JWST in a while, and well, I think it's probably time for an update. Now, most of us have long ago given up waiting for this mission to launch. I mean, it was supposed to launch in 2007, then 2009, and then 2018, and now NASA has said, for sure, absolutely, positively, JWST will launch in March 2021. I promise. Pinky swear and hope to die. March 2021. Okay. Well, in their defense, it looks like things might actually happen. Maybe. At least, they put the thing together. Incredibly, JWST is now costing around the $9 billion mark, which is a cost comparable to building an aircraft carrier. And I've already given you my opinions on this. I think, fine, whatever. I'd rather have this than an aircraft carrier if we're going to spend that kind of money. But you'd think that when that much money is at stake, the project can move along a little bit faster. Now, many of you have understandably pointed out that this looks like just another military contractor gone rogue and is gouging the U.S. taxpayer for all they can. And, well, I guess I'm finding it very difficult to defend that the way this project has been funded. So you've got a good point there. JWST is being paid via something called a cost-plus contract, which means that Northrop Grumman, who's the main contractor for JWST, isn't on the hook financially for cost overruns and delays. NASA uses these types of contracts whenever there is insufficient experience in building something that would make committing money to the project extremely risky. Basically, NASA takes all the risks from the company and puts it onto the taxpayer. Now, this isn't nothing new, however. NASA uses cost-plus contracts a lot, and back in the 60s, they used it during the Apollo program, where, if you think about it, basically nothing existed or was built prior to that program for space use. So they needed to build everything from scratch. So cost-plus contracts aren't anything new. And really, if you think about it, JWST is a lot like Apollo when it comes to new stuff that's needed to do the science that's required of it. For example, the onboard near and mid-infrared detectors, the sunshield materials, the microshutters and wavefront sensing and control all had to be invented first, and then it needed to be approved by NASA before it could be included in the telescope. Other things, lightweight cryogenic mirrors, cryogenic detector readout application-specific integrated circuits, cryogenic heat switches, a cryocooler for the mid-infrared instrument, and a large precision cryogenic structure, which basically was the entire primary mirror backplane, including both the materials and the design. So all of this stuff has never before been on any satellite or space hardware ever. Now, the microshutters are particularly amazing, and I believe will absolutely spawn technological spin-offs that are on both Earth and space-based telescopes. Microshutters are tiny doorways, which are the width of just a few hairs, that will allow scientists to remotely and systematically block out unwanted light and view the most distant stars and galaxies humans have ever seen. The James Webb Space Telescope will be the first to use this technology, but I think they will prove extremely useful in all kinds of other optical applications where you need to block out a bright thing to see a dim thing. So look for those in future telescopes. Still though, I get the impatience and frustration because I feel it too. I think this thing could have been built a lot cheaper and a lot quicker if Northrop Grumman had been held at least somewhat accountable for their management of the project. But it's too late for that now, and here we are in 2019, and it looks like we finally have a completed telescope. So, woohoo! So, early this week, NASA announced that JWST is assembled, and it has passed a crucial first test for the completed telescope. They successfully deployed the sun shield for the first time. And this is a big deal, maybe the biggest deal, because if that thing doesn't unfurl, then JWST is in deep doo-doo. And I'm sorry, but that is an actual mission vocabulary there. Deep doo-doo is one of the milestones to officially avoid. So anyway, they did the test by simulating the null gravity of space by attaching special pulleys that compensated for the pull of Earth's gravity in the lab. Doesn't do any good to try to unfurl this thing under gravity because it'll get hung up. And interestingly, in previous unfurling tests, before they attached it to the telescope, they turned it in all kinds of different directions. They hung it upside down, they moved it sideways, to make sure that things don't get hung up unexpectedly. And those were the tests, by the way, that caused the most recent delay of the mission. When they were testing that, unfurling, somebody forgot to remove some screws and made some other rookie mistakes when testing the unfurling that caused NASA to move the timeline back a few more years. So this is pretty hard stuff, and Northrop dropped the ball during that phase of the mission. But probably more than any other component on JWST, the 5-layer tennis court-sized sun shield is the most crucial to the mission, and it's the most fragile. If this thing doesn't deploy, then the electronics, detectors, and everything else needed for JWST to see what it needs to see won't get cool enough to work properly. This thing gets hung up anywhere along the way, and the whole thing is useless. It's a little worse than that, though, because the telescope itself is so big that it has to be folded in on itself in a variety of ways to fit in the rocket. The enormous primary mirror assembly has to be folded up. You can see that in this image. And the secondary tower assembly has to be bunched up. And of course, all 5 layers of the sun shield are rolled up and stowed to fit inside the rocket fairing. So this thing is really smooshed up in there. Now, many components have already been individually tested for the space environment. They've shock tested them for launch, and they've cryogenically tested them for operating in the cold of space separately. And so far, everything has passed. So that's good. Now, what's next, now that the whole thing is together for these guys, is they are going to painstakingly roll the sun shield back up into its stowed position for flight. Then, the entire observatory will be subjected to comprehensive electrical tests. It'll go through one more set of mechanical tests that will emulate the launch vibration environment. They're going to shake the crap out of it. And then they're going to deploy the whole thing one more time, and then stow it again one more time on the ground before it's ready for its flight into space. But wait, that's not all. After that, which should happen over the course of the first half of this year, or in the next year, they're going to put the whole thing on a barge. A barge. They're going to just put on a truck, put it on a barge, and then they're going to sail it from California to the launch site, all the way through the Panama Canal, and go to French Guiana, where it will be put on an Ariane 5 rocket to go up into space. So, there is no shortage of tense moments here when it comes to this mission. And that's still nothing compared to the nervousness I'm going to feel during the actual launch and deployment phase. Once launched and JWST heads to the L2 point where it will do its work, NASA will take about 2 weeks to fully deploy the telescope. That's after it gets launched and it's on its way past the moon. It'll take about a month after launch to get where it's going, and then it will start to take first light images sometime, I assume, in late 2021. At least, that's the story so far. And I will keep you posted. Well, that is it for this episode, space fans. These videos are brought to you by Deep Astronomy Patreon patrons who make sure that they keep coming out. And if you like this content and would like to support what we're doing here, then please consider becoming a patron. Any amount helps, and all of it goes back into making content. And another way to support, if you're so inclined, is to purchase from OPT Telescopes. My affiliate link is in the description box. And if you want a telescope or an accessory for yourself or some kind of space gift, then they are a great company. They send all over the world, and purchasing anything from them using that link helps Deep Astronomy. So thanks to all of you for watching. And as always, keep looking up.